Hey crew, I've got the key to that 2018 Aston Martin DB11 V12. We are going to take it for a drive, but first, let's check out how it looks on the inside and outside. Nothing aesthetically has changed on the DB11 in the last four model years, so that means up front we're still looking at this open mouth grille with these black slats here with the black exterior package, and that goes for the extended front splitter in gloss black. Get your Aston Martin wings perched up top. The design of these have actually just changed by Aston Martin, but not here for this 2018. There are full LED headlights and LED DRLs. You get some ventilation on the hood. And this one's painted in lime essence, but to my eyes, it looks more like a gold. I mean, I can see a little hint of that green. There's tons of metallic flake on the paint as well. The wheels are 20-inch front and rear. On this one, they're optionally painted to match the exterior color. Not my cup of tea, but you know, to each his own. There are optional black painted calipers clamping on those slotted rotors, and the tires are Bridgestone Potenzas, 255 section front and 295s in the rear. The black and yellow design theme continues to mingle with the extended two-tone mirrors, window trim, and that yellow roof panel. Stepping back to look at the profile, which on the DB11 is so windswept, and they did an amazing job hiding functional aerodynamics into this look. I do want to thank NBL Auto Club here in Azusa, California, who are letting me review their DB11. So if you're interested in auto body work, mechanical work, or if you just want to rent some of their luxury vehicles like this one, check them out. I'll put their info in the description. At the back, we have these very slender LED taillights, this hidden aero spoiler, black gloss diffuser, and two blacked out exhaust ports. Love the hole punching around those as well. I don't often say this, but the rear end of this DB11 is my favorite view. I don't often say it because automakers, no pun intended, often half-arse the rear end design, not here on the DB11. And it just flows with this sensuous exterior that I would choose in a different color with different wheels. Let's check out the interior. To open up, we press in on this portion of the door handle that pops it out, and then we extend these swan hinge doors, which move at an upward angle to help you avoid scraping against curbs that you park next to. That's just so clever. Looking inside, we have a black leather interior with an Alcantara headliner. These seats are optionally with the Brogue detailing down the center and the Nexus quilting pattern. They're heated and ventilated up front, and we have the yellow accented stitching and the DB11 embroidered on the headrest. To access the back seats, pull on this leather tab, and then we wait a sec as the seat moves down and then angles forward and then power adjusts. That still doesn't give me a wide access point to the rear seats, but you know what? I have a feeling they're not intended for full-size adults. I'm gonna try it anyway, just because I like to torture myself. I'm gonna move the seat back, but it's gonna notice that my knees are here and then we'll adjust forward. So the driver won't be in their ideal driving position if they are tall. And then here at 6 feet, behind my own seat, I have no knee room. The foot pockets don't exist and the headroom is also non-existent. My head is so craned forward. I would not wanna be here for any length of time, maybe 5 minutes if I really like the driver or I'm really interested in the car. And then back here, we don't have any cup holders or console or anything like that. There's just lots of leather and Alcantara everywhere. To get out, pull the strap, and wait a sec. Now that I've extracted myself from those rear seats, let's take stock of the door panel, which, like much of this cabin, is covered in that sumptuous leather. We have Brogue detailing, yellow contrast stitching, and then this chopped carbon fiber inlay. We get that based on how the carbon fiber cures in the resin. So cool with this matte finish. Aluminum door pulls feel solid. Two one-touch windows, power adjusting and power folding door mirrors. Press and hold that button to release the trunk. It doesn't pop it up. Inside, we find 10 cubic feet of space, which is enough for a set of golf clubs or two medium-sized suitcases, and it's not a high lip, so it's easy to slide cargo in. Oh, heavy close on that trunk lid. There's a hand-built in England plaque here, and then it's so easy to get in because the door opening is so far forward, I don't have to bunch up my legs, just kind of fully extend them and slide in. Solid sound of that door close. There is a leather wrapped steering wheel, almost a squared off look to it. Perfect thickness in the hands. giant aluminum paddles on the back of the wheel made from, I already said that, aluminum. They sound so good. Digital instrument cluster here with this sort of 3D effect to it. With no head-up display, but leather, again, everywhere, including around the 8-inch infotainment system, which is not a touchscreen. You have to control it via this trackpad here or the wheel. This is old Mercedes-Benz command technology. Didn't like it in those vehicles. Don't really like it here. Tons of complicated menus. No Apple CarPlay or Android Auto, even up to 2022. This owner has an aftermarket patch in. Otherwise, you're dealing with this. There's leather around the air vents, around your gear selections, start-stop button, HVAC controls, seat heating and ventilation are there, your camera button is there. The console and cup holders, pull this once, and it power slides back for your cup holders, pull it again. And you have access to more space, two USBs, and a DC outlet. Visibility with the high belt line is somewhat constrained, and you don't have blind spot monitoring or rear cross traffic as standard. This cabin, exquisite material quality, gorgeous design layout, needs a better infotainment. Now let's take the DB11 V12 for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. The overrun on startup just kind of setting the tone. I do believe there's a quiet start as well where you can hold the start stop button and it won't do quite the same theatrics, just, you know, to keep your neighbors happy with you. You select the drive mode from here and the suspension setting from here. We'll hit the R button to bring up a surround view camera system and a high resolution backup camera with trajectory lines. D takes us to drive, then we've got a front-facing camera as well. We'll start with a turning radius test, as usual. Cranked. Very light steering. Decent turning radius as well. How about the world-famous horn test? Let's see how we do. Yeah. That carries. The turn signal almost sounds like a heartbeat. Thunk, 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 thunk. It's kind of cool. Oh, those parking sensors are awfully sensitive. We're all about the sounds here at Miles Per Hour. And the DB11 has some good ones. And some not so good ones, the parking sensors. No. Over this rougher road initially, a lot of crags and misaligned pavement, bumps, undulations, the DB11 suspension with the adaptive dampers takes it flawlessly. I stay very comfortable in these seats, which don't have loads of padding, but are extremely ergonomic. They just contour to my body perfectly. There is some rattling going on, like over here in the door panel, which could become tedious on daily. This car is targeted as a GT car, so comfort is paramount alongside power. Speaking of power, this car has a lot of it. 5.2 liter twin turbocharged V12 that makes 600 horsepower and 516 pound-feet of torque. If this was a 22 DB11 V12, it would be making 630 horsepower because it inherited the tuning that came with the AMR version of the DB11 in 2019 for all contemporary models. If you don't want the V12, which is just silky smooth right now, you can opt for a twin turbocharged V8 that for 22 gets a 25 horsepower bump, so it makes 528 horsepower. That engine comes from Mercedes AMG, thanks to the partnership that Aston Martin has with them.
whichever engine you choose. It's paired with an 8-speed automatic gearbox and sends all of its thrust to just the rear tires. Here in GT mode, I'm so comfortable that I'm not even tempted on this very twisty, very attractive canyon road to drive it like a maniac. I'm enjoying the buttery smoothness of that throttle tip-in, the ease upon which I can apply the brakes and we can scrub speed, the light steering feel that's still communicative, the composed body, all that rattling that's coming from the doors. That is probably the most annoying thing about this car right now. Just so much vibration from both door panels. That doesn't tell me luxury. Now, if I was tempted and I did want to drive with a bit more pace, I could hit this sport button on the right side of the wheel to put it into sport powertrain, and I can then hit the suspension button on the left side of the wheel to stiffen the dampers just a little bit. And what that's going to do is add just a touch of resistance to the steering. It's going to hasten the throttle response and more urgently access all 600 horsepower. Now we're talking. I don't have to tell you that we find ourselves on an excellent road here. And with its mix of tight corners and longer sweepers, we have the environment to properly test the DB11's components, the braking, the chassis control, the abundant power, this transmission, which in sport mode seems to find the right gear for what we need in each situation. The stiffened up dampers keep the body composed. Over off and on camber corners and undulations, even mid-corner. You can see how the DB11 V12 has a top speed of 208 miles per hour. This engine has so much in it. It does not yield, it just keeps pushing. And to return to the miles per hour obsession with sound, what do we think about that V12 soundtrack? Did the twin turbos kill it compared to vehicles like the Vanquish with the NA V12? I still think it's a sweet noise. I don't think it's as good as that Vanquish V12. Now, I do think we owe it to the DB11 to see how good the V12 can sound with full tilt acceleration while also demonstrating both a 0-60 test and braking performance. So with the race box set up here, I'm going to go into Sport Plus drive mode. Coast is clear. I'm going to brake boost it because we don't have a launch control system. Build up to about 2,000. Let go. And 3.95 from 60-ish. Ooh, those brakes felt good. Very good. Short stopping distance, good resistance on the pedal, and a 0-60 time of 3.95 seconds. And that is about 0.05 of a second off the pace of what Aston Martin quotes the 0-60 figure is for this car. Now you think 600 horsepower could be getting to 60 quicker than that. The issue here with the DB11 V12 is that, one, this engine doesn't make a ton of low-end torque despite the big power, it kind of comes in later. And two, without a launch control system, it doesn't build up those RPMs to what you need it to get out of the hole quickly. Now, it did do a launch control in another environment, trying it in manual mode to see if that helped at all, and all I was getting was tire spin to the rear wheels. So that is as good as you're gonna see, 3.95 seconds. Plenty quick, but 0-60 acceleration is not this vehicle's strongest attribute, nor do I think it's going to be intense corner carving, but that doesn't mean we're not gonna try it. So from the Sport Plus drive mode, I'm gonna hit the suspension button one more time to put us in the stiffest setting, then I'm gonna pull a paddle to take us into manual control, and we're gonna see what happens. Feels very large for this road. And the corners come up all too quickly for the V12 power. But the chassis is remarkably well dialed. It's so in control of itself. And as before, the steering is talking to me. The brakes are biting in. The traction control system, which cannot be defeated, even in Sport Plus, will put a nanny or two on you, so you don't end up in any trouble. And on this road, you might not mind, because the alternative off there doesn't look very good. Look, I know this is ridiculous. This is a GT car. It is not a tight canyon carver. But I do this to demonstrate how expertly Aston Martin has developed this chassis and all these inputs, because I can do it and feel confident doing so. When it's totally not this car's game. This is more on the mark for the DB11 V12. Suspension in soft, powertrain in sport lets you uncork a little of that V12 while leaning into the GT ride quality and comfort. Here, the DB11 absolutely excels. Day. So let's talk about what also is on the table if you're looking for a GT in the $200,000-ish price territory. Real quick, this car for 2022 starts at $202,000 for the V8 version. If you want the V12, you're gonna have to pony up an extra 50 grand. The fuel economy for this car is 15 mpg city, 22 on the highway, and 18 combined. Not bad for a V12. And again, 630 horsepower for 22, just 600 for this 2018 model. 0 to 60 also drops down by 3/10 of a second to 3.6 seconds for the 22 model year relative to this 2018's 3.9. Cars you might consider: the Bentley W12, Bentley Continental GT W12. That one starts at $220,000. It makes 626 horsepower. It gets to 60 with its all-wheel drive system in a scant 3.4 seconds. The top speed is 1 mph, slower than this at 207 miles per hour, and the mpg is 2, worse than this at 16 combined. I've driven that car. It is a boat, a lovely boat, and it leans more heavily on the comfort side of the GT equation while still being ludicrously quick in a straight line. But I wouldn't feel comfortable doing the stuff I just did in the DB11 in the Continental GT. I haven't driven the other one to consider, the Ferrari Roma. That one starts at $226,500. It makes 612 horsepower from its twin turbo V8. It gets to 60 in 3.2 seconds. It is lighter than this vehicle. And it gets 19 combined mpg, 1 mpg better. And the top speed is less at 199 miles per hour. Not having driven the Roma, I can't say dynamically if it's better than this car, but having seen one in person, I do think that the styling of the DB11 in the right color is more effective. But for now, DB11 gets the big thumbs up for me. Three knocks on it, infotainment. Even in 22, we're still using the same setup, so I can say this is dated. The color, we choose something else, and that rattling noise from the door panels. That does bother me. I hope you guys have enjoyed this POV drive review as much as I've enjoyed making it. If you did, please like, comment, and share the video. Subscribe to the channel. Hit that bell to get notified. And it's into Sport Plus. And I'll see you next time.